precious Father in heaven,
yes,
we take this opportunity to say thank you so very much for all that you do for us, for your guidance and protection in and out of our homes. You always keep us safe, even in the middle of the night when we are asleep. You watch over us and awake us every day, showing that we still have the life and strength, and most of all, the privilege to worship and honor your precious name. Father, so many things you do for us in our everyday life, and sometimes they are just taken for granted. Father, we are deeply sorry for all our shortcomings and sins that we have committed before thy sight. Oh, Father, you know the holy purpose of our gathering. We are gathered in different parts of the world to call upon thy holy name, to worship you this very moment, to offer our praise of thanksgiving this very moment. Oh, Father, may you take the time for us to be accepted, to receive us one by one, and to accept our praises of thanks and the amount of what we may have set aside to help our brothers and sisters who are truly in need of your help because of the persecution and oppression that may have gone into their lives. Oh, Father, you are the only one that can comfort us all. And this is the reason why we invite you in our worship service like this. May we feel your embrace. We cannot see you or hold you, oh Father, but we can experience your presence when you start wrapping around your arms around us through means of your spirit that you send. We, oh Father, assure of one thing, that you are in our midst. Don't go away from your people. Our true happiness is to spend our time with you, not only in worship service like this, but like what we have sung in our Psalms of Praises, that after we have been refined as gold is refined, then we will be there with you to spend eternity with you in the holy city that we all aspire for. But while we all wait for that great day of the sending of your begotten Son, some may have rest in their journey. They are there in their graves, just waiting for them to be resurrected. But for us who are still alive, if it is possible that we will be amongst those who are caught to be alive, to meet with our Savior and spend our eternity with you and our Lord Jesus. Our Lord Jesus, you have sacrificed so much for us. You have given your life for us. So help us, O Lord, to stand our grounds, that whenever we are experiencing hardships, whenever we are in a dilemma or problems, help us to look up to you and to see that we carry on what we have stood for. Help us to be like you, steadfast in the faith, to always follow our God, come what may. Because it is through you, O Lord, that you have set a good example for us to follow, so that we will no longer turn away from you and from our Father, but we will remain as true members of your church. But we must admit, O Lord, there are times in our lives that we feel very weak. There are times in our lives that we get sick. There are times in our life that we get confused. Bring our prayers to our Father. Help us in our burden. Help us to carry on. Help us to finish this race that we have started. We know, O Lord, through you and through the help of our Father, we will make it to the finish line. We will be amongst those who will spend our eternity with you and our Father on the second advent that you will come. Father, we return to you and ask that you bless the one that will officiate the worship service maybe take the power that comes from you so that all those who will listen to your teachings will be edified and strengthened in their hope and faith to carry on the journey and the responsibility and task that you have given to your people. Father, we ask everything once again and praise you for all that you do for us. Thank you for being a father and a God to your people. We ask everything in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Brothers and sisters in the faith. Once again, we are very thankful to our Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ, not only for the borrowed life and strength that we have, but most especially for the faith that has been instilled in our hearts, knowing that it is our divine duty to worship and magnify the name of our Lord God in heaven. It is truly important for each and every one of us to continue with our sojourn, but not merely traveling in this world blindly or just following another person, but to truly understand the purpose of our journey. And that purpose is for us to be able to reach our final destination, to be able to receive the grace of salvation. In the whole process of our sojourn, it is very easy for one to grow tired, to grow weary, or to be led astray, be distracted, or to turn away. If ever anyone were to fall into any of those kind of distractions or hindrances, then we will ultimately fail in our attempt to receive the grace of salvation. And in our sojourn, beloved brothers and sisters, it is for us to continue living a life that is of a true member of the Church of Christ, followers of our Lord Jesus Christ. And one of the things that we have received in the Bible studies and doctrines, the fundamental doctrines of the Iglesia Ni Cristo, is that we have a love for brotherhood, loving one another as commanded by our Lord God, to love Him and to love others the way we love ourselves. Now, it is not easy to do that, especially if we all know that we may not be blood brothers. Even blood brothers grew up together all their lives tend to fight, tend to have misunderstandings, and even end up hating each other. Much more if we don't even know each other personally, we're not blood related. Yet, as members of the Church of Christ, we have been taught that we consider one another as true brothers and sisters. So if we are in this situation that we have been displaced, we have been expelled by the institution for standing for what is right and continuing to follow God's teachings and commandments, are we still expected to love one another as brothers and sisters? That's why the lesson that we will study today is based on the fundamental doctrines of the Church of Christ, the lessons taught by Brother Ranyo G. Manalo, to ensure that what we are following are the pristine doctrines that we have received. So why do we continue to love one another as brothers and sisters? Let us start our study as we read what is written here in Matthew 23 and verses 8 up to 9. But do not be called rabbi, teacher, for one is your teacher, and you are all equally brothers. Do not call anyone on earth who guides you spiritually your father, for one is your father, he who is heaven. Now, it is very straightforward, according to our Lord Jesus Christ, even though he is teaching the words of our Lord God. He is the one who's spiritually guiding his disciples, yet he do not consider himself that one should be called teacher or rabbi, or to be called father, because all of us, according to our Lord Jesus Christ, are all equally brothers and sisters in faith. That's why even though we have our spiritual leaders, even if we have ministers or church workers, we don't call them father, we call them brother, and we call one another as brothers and sisters. And according to our Lord Jesus Christ, we only have one father, and that is not our biological father, as we call our dad, papa, daddy. But our Father in heaven, we have one Father, and he is the one who is in heaven. So if he is our Father, and we are all his children, that's why we're all brothers and sisters. Who then are the ones who are at risk of losing their right to be called children of our Lord God? Let's read Deuteronomy chapter 32 and the verses 5 up to 6. They have corrupted themselves. They are not his children because of their blemish, a perverse and crooked generation. Do you thus deal with the Lord, foolish and unwise people? Is he not your father who bought you? Has he not made you and established you? According to the Bible, those who belong to a perverse and crooked generation, those who are corrupted because of their blemish, are not considered children of our Lord God in heaven. So if everyone started as children of our Lord God, because we have one Father, the risk of losing that right to be called children of our Lord God happens when one has blemish in his life, when he has joined a corrupted generation, a crooked and perverse generation. If they deviate from following or being obedient to the will of our Lord God, then they lose their right to be called children of our Lord God. So if these people are no longer considered children of God, then who do they belong to? And how would we know which is which? Let us read what is written here in 1 John chapter 3 and the verses 10 up to 12. This is how we know who the children of God are and who the children of the devil are. Anyone who does not do what is right is not God's child, nor is anyone who does not love their brother and sister. For this is the message you heard from the beginning. We should love one another. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brothers were righteous. Now, beloved brothers and sisters, we all know that if one is no longer considered children of our Lord God, he then in effect becomes a child of the devil, enemy of our Lord God. Now, we already know that if anyone belongs to the devil, he will not be saved come judgment day. That is why it is important for us to always have a check with ourselves. Am I still among those considered children of our Lord God? That's why to know which ones belong to God, which ones belong to the devil, according to the Bible, anyone who does not do what is right, what is commanded by our Lord God, what is written in the whole scriptures, is not God's child. And anyone who does not love their brother and sister, do you see that there is somewhat of a qualification that they quantify that anyone who does not do what is right is not God's child, meaning they belong to the devil. And a special mention to those who do not love their brother and sister. That's why there was also a mention of Cain, as you probably remember the story of Cain, who murdered his own brother. Now, you might think, oh, I'm not going to murder my brother. I'm not going to kill him. I may hate him, but, you know, I don't think I can kill him. Now, what about those people who continue to profess that they are children of God, that they have the exclusive rights to be saved come judgment day, yet they hate one another? They hate other people, especially those whom they consider as their enemies. They spread hatred and bigotry toward others. Let's read what's written in 1 John chapter 4 and the verses 7 up to 8 and 20. Dear friends, let us practice loving each other, for love comes from God, and those who are loving and kind show that they are the children of God and that they are getting to know him better. But if a person isn't loving and kind, it shows that he doesn't know God, for God is love. If anyone says, I love God, but keeps on hating his brother, he is a liar. For if he doesn't love his brother who is right there in front of him, how can he love God whom he has never seen? So this is true, beloved brothers and sisters. It's easy to say that you love somebody, you have to love our Lord God. But we all know that you cannot see the true God. You can easily say that you love God whom you cannot see, yet the person right in front of you, your brother, your sister, you cannot love him, and then you end up hating him. So even if you say that you love him, even if you say you love God, but keeps on hating your brother or sister, he is considered a liar in the sight of our Lord God. Now, beloved brothers and sisters, do you know anybody who might have this kind of hatred towards others? You know, even if he's a spiritual leader. I just can't seem to fathom what would drive a person, especially if he is a religious leader, to hate so much that he can hate his own mother, his father, his brothers, his sister, or anyone whom he suspect to question his authority. Hate them so much that they're willing to have them exiled or drive them away or have them put to jail or have them be vilified in social media, be cursed at by his own congregation, and yet still pick up the Bible and preach the words of our Lord God and claim that they are the only ones to lose. It's so hard to imagine a person who's supposed to profess love and scriptures, the words of our Lord God, and then teach about hatred and bigotry towards others. Does that make that person who hates his brother just merely a liar? This is what is mentioned here. Is it only a liar in the sight of our Lord God? Let's read what's written here in 1 John chapter 3 and verses 11 and 15. For this is the message which you believers have heard from the beginning of your relationship with Christ, that we should unselfishly love and the best for one another. Everyone who hates, works against his brother in Christ, is at heart a murderer by God's standards. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. So if a spiritual leader who hates his brother and sister and his own mother professes the words of our Lord God, is considered a liar in the Bible and also a murderer in God's sight and does not have eternal life abiding in him, how can he be the instrument for his congregation or his institution to be saved? That's very ironic, don't you think, beloved brothers and sisters? That is why it is important for us to truly understand the value of brotherhood. Loving others who may not be even related to you. Love others you may not know. Loving others, especially in their time of need and distress. Helping them in their time of weakness. That is something that shows love, unselfish love, and seeking the best for others. Because if one were to say that he loves God, yet continues to hate others, works against others, they are considered murderers in the sight of our Lord. So no matter what other people, agencies, institutions, or even court says that no, they're not murderers, they did not pick up a gun and shoot that person or picked up a knife and stabbed him to death. No. But in the sight and standard of our Lord God, they are considered murderers, and eternal life or salvation will not abide in them. Now, does our Lord Jesus Christ actually teach this doctrine of loving others as brothers and sisters, that we should follow it to prove that we truly are disciples or followers of our Lord Jesus Christ? So let's ask our Lord Jesus Christ himself. Let's read what's written here in Matthew chapter 5. And the verse is 21 up to 22. You have heard that our ancestors were told, you must not murder. If you commit murder, you are subject to judgment. But I say, if you are even angry with someone, you are subject to judgment. If you call someone an idiot, you are in danger of being brought before the court. And if you curse someone, you are in danger of the fires of hell. So during the time of the Christian era, the time of our Lord Jesus Christ, a person doesn't need to pick up a knife and stab somebody to death to be considered a murderer, to commit murder. Because even the act of being angry or calling someone idiot or cursing someone, hating someone, endangers a person's salvation by committing him to the fires of hell. So that's how things have changed during the Christian era. Hating somebody will make us a murderer in the sight of our Lord. So how should we be careful as not to fall into the same mistakes as others, especially like our ancestors, as mentioned in verse? Let us read Proverbs chapter 11 in the verses 9. With their mouths, the godless destroy their neighbors, but through knowledge, the righteous escape. So what is one of the ways that we should be careful not to fall into the same mistake as our ancestors? By guarding our mouths. Because with our mouths, the Bible says, the godless destroy their neighbors. So what is one of the ways that our mouths symbolically can be used to destroy our love for our neighbors or others? Let's read Proverbs 16 and the verses 28. Gossip is spread by wicked people. They stir up trouble and break up relationships. So according to the Bible, gossip is spread by wicked people. So now, because of the age of technology and information, it is not just merely by the mouth, even by the fingers when one is to text or type in words and spread on social media. That's how they spread gossip. Now, probably a lot of you are familiar with people who are gossip mongrels. You know, there's a common term now that they use, especially in the Philippines. They call it marites. You know, no offense to people who are actually named marites. It's a marites because it's a short term for mare anong latest. You know, mare is like a person you usually gossip with, and then yeah, they're asking what's the latest news, what's the latest. There's also Maris, if you know what's Maris. It's Mare Anong Chismis. Chismis is gossip. So people are very attuned to hearing gossip because it's probably a way to spice up their life. If they find their life to be mundane, they would look into others and see oh, there's drama over there. There's some controversy over here. So they're always looking for what's the latest, what's the chismis, and there's also Marisol. Pare, who's very good at making sulsol. You know, sulsol is aggravating the situation. And there's also Marina. It's the Mare, ano na. You know what ano na means? It means, oh, what's up? They're following up what's the latest with the chismis or the gossip. Now, there's an addition now because of, like I said, our time and age. It's Mariposa. You know what's Mariposa? It's a Mare who's also good at social media. So when they find something, a chismis or a gossip, instead of just talking among themselves, they would say, Mare, post mo na. Use it on social media. So they spread it so fast now that you don't have to physically go to another barangay or another town to spread gossip. You just post it in social media and it spreads like wildfire. Remember, gossip, whether it's true or not, stirs up controversy. It brings drama into somebody's life, but this is spread by wicked people. So obviously, children of our Lord God are not supposed to be wicked people. So they're not supposed to be spreading gossip because this will stir up trouble and break up relationship. Imagine relationship with your loved one, relationship with your best friend, relationship with your brother and sister. That can easily break up because of God. So if we truly are children of our Lord God, what should we embody in our lives as members of the Church of Christ? And not as wicked people. Colossians chapter 3 and the verses 12 up to 14. You are people of God. He loved you and chose you for his own. So then you must clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Be tolerant with one another and forgive one another whenever any of you has a complaint against someone else. You must forgive one another just as the Lord has forgiven you. And to all these qualities, add love, which binds all things together in perfect unity. Are we members of the Church of Christ? Yes. Then we should embody this in our life. As people of God, let's express compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. There are people who may have misperfections, imperfections in their lives. But then if we have that humility and kindness towards others, even if they have imperfections, even if they have things that can offend us, we may have complaint against them. But if we truly love one another, then we will be tolerable towards one another. For whatever imperfections we may have, we would understand one another. We would remind one another if ever we see somebody who may not be showing this Christian value in their lives, let's remind one another. Because this is what will give us the proof to our Lord God that we are embodying the love that he has for us. Our Lord God gave our Lord Jesus Christ to die on the cross for our sins, not his, our sins. What unselfish act can be more than that? And because of love, there is perfect unity in all the things that we do. Because if there is love, no matter how much a person may hate or be angry at one another, but because of love, we would be able to fix if ever there are broken hearts, if ever there are anger issues, if ever there are misunderstanding. What can one accomplish if he is able to embody all of these traits that is mentioned by Apostle Paul? What would happen in our life, in our relationship with others? Let's read 1 Peter chapter 1 and the verse is 12. 22. Since by our obedience to the truth, you have purified yourself for a sincere love of the believers, see that you love one another from the heart, always unselfishly seeking the best for one another. If we embody all of those traits as true members of the Church of Christ, then we can love one another from the heart, meaning we will be sincere in our love for one another. If you are sincere with your love for others, then you would seek what is best for them. And not when something good is happening to them, instead of being supportive and being happy for them, you find ways that they be going back to their miserable lives. You pull them by the leg. The crab mentality all over again. That is not what true Christians are all about. So we will be able to love one another sincerely from the heart, and we will be able to do what is best for them. Now, probably you might be thinking, brother, I know all of those things that I should do. I know those verses that I've received even during the time that I was attending worship service and Bible studies. But unfortunately, I'm going through a rough time as well. I'm going through trials. There's hardship in my life. There's sorrow. There are those who are going through persecution and oppression. Sometimes it's hard to think about loving others when you yourself find yourself in a difficult situation. So how can we be strengthened in our life, in our faith, as we go through life, through hardships and sorrow, and still be able to love our brothers and sisters? Let us read the last verse here in 1 John chapter 4 and the verses 10 up to 12. In this act, we see what real love is. It's not our love for God, but His love for us when He sent His Son to satisfy God's anger against our sins. Dear friends, since God loved us so much as that, we surely ought to love each other too. For though we have never yet seen God, when we love each other, God lives in us, and His love within us grows even stronger. Imagine a person filled with hatred and anger. What do you see in that person's life? Even through his eyes, you would see there's misery. There's regret. There's so much anger. There's so much bitterness. And that person will just waste away emotionally, mentally, physically, spiritually. But a person who has let go of all of that hatred and anger and is able to embody the true love, real love, as mentioned in the Bible, the kind of love that our Lord God showed each and every one of us, that person will live a content and happy life. He will be spiritually renewed, and he will grow stronger because God will live in each of us. In our lives, we will become stronger. We will have endurance in this life only if we have the real love that is shown to us by our Lord God, that we can show towards our brothers and sisters. Beloved brothers and sisters, even though we are in this situation, that we are sojourning in the wilderness, yet we know the path that God is leading us is a path towards salvation. And all the things that we are encountering in life are merely lessons for us to truly know what love is, to truly know what God wants for each and every one of us. So let us deny ourselves, let us forgive ourselves, let us forgive one another, and let us continue to love one another as true members of the Church of Christ, to love our brothers and sisters the way we love ourselves, to do what is best for them, unselfishly seeking what is best for them. This is the kind of love that has been taught to the true members of the Church of Christ. That is what up to now we are able to do what others may fail to do. We are able to love others. We are able to help one another. We are able to help those who are persecuted and oppressed, unselfishly seeking to help them so that they too will be able to be set free and to be able to join us in serving our Lord God in heaven. This is our lesson for today. Let us all stand and we shall pray. Our loving Father in heaven, thank you so much, O God, because once again, you have reminded us of how much you love your children. Despite our many shortcomings and iniquities, you have embraced us with your love. You have cleansed us of our sins. You have given us a clean slate in order for us to do what is fitting before your sight. Father in heaven, as we sojourn, we will grow weak. We will get tired. There are times that we would cry unto you and almost give up. Oh, at those moments, Father, please send forth the Holy Spirit. Renew our strength. Renew our faith. Lift us up, Father, and embrace us with your loving arms. Allow us to be strengthened once more so that we may be used as your instrument for your love and your will towards others, our brothers and sisters who are in need, those who are persecuted and oppressed, because it is our faith, Father. At your appointed time, all of this will come to pass. We will all be vindicated. We'll be set free to magnify and glorify your holy name. Father, we pray for those who are oppressing our brothers and sisters. Please, Father, if it is according to your will, let them repent. Have them a change of heart and life so that they too may be able to know what real love is and embody it in their life so that all of us will have that chance for the grace of salvation come judgment day. Please, Father, bless your children wherever they may be. If there are those who may be ill, Father, send for the Holy Spirit. Bring back their health. Allow them to use their life and strength so that all of us will be able to continue to worship and magnify your holy name. Please, Father, bless the children. Allow them to have a good life. Please, Father, teach them your words and your commandments so that in their life they will follow you, come what may. They will be the ones who will continue in our faith so that at the day of judgment, all of us, including our loved ones, will all be the recipients of the grace of salvation. Our Lord Jesus Christ, thank you so much. Because of you, the Father listens to our prayers. He listens to our supplications and continue to grant our requests and forgive us of the sins that we have committed. Our Father in heaven, we are confident that we have received the many blessings coming from you, that you have sent forth the Holy Spirit in each of the household of your children. And all of us will be able to continue in our sojourn, knowing that you are the one holding us by the hand and leading us towards our salvation. For all of these things, we humbly ask and beg in the name of our Lord Christ Jesus. Amen. May the grace of salvation from our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen.